Hello, everybody. Thank you for your patience and for bearing with us as we overcome our technical difficulties. I want to let you know that we have online interpreters in the room that you can spotlight if you need them. We also have captioning, and the captioning is available by pressing the caption button on the bottom of the screen. I'm Dr. George Taleporos, and I'm the independent chair of every Australian account. And I'm joined by Nick Avery and Ross Joyce, who are on our steering committee. Welcome, both of you, and welcome to everyone that is here today. I also want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land and pay our respects to elders past, present, and emerging. I'm on Wurundjeri land. It's a lovely day out there, a bit windy, but it's good to be with you. Let's go to some housekeeping. That's all right, Nick. Obviously, we're all feeling quite stressed. Some of us are quite unhappy, and some of us are quite annoyed by the recent changes that have come in through the legislation. But it's really important that we remember that we're all here to make the NDIS better, and that includes that people from the NDIA, that people who are here today are very, very respectful, and I would like to also make sure that we have a respectful conversation. You're welcome to speak about your own experiences, but the NDIA won't be able to provide individual answers to your situations. And because we don't have a lot of time, I'm going to go straight to the presentation now from Nick. Nick, over to you.
Thanks, George. Okay. So we're going to do a quick summary of the Every Australian Counts survey on the NDIS changes. The survey is still open. At the moment, we have 320 responses as of yesterday, and we would really appreciate if you could all share the survey with your networks. We will pop the link to the survey in the chat. A big thank you to everyone who has filled out the survey so far. Your comments and feedback are really helpful in our advocacy work. And I'm going to do just a very brief summary so that we have as much time as possible for your questions today. Okay. So we asked some demographic information in the survey. People were able to tick as many boxes as applied to their situation. 267 of the survey respondents were NDIS participants. 135 were family members of NDIS participants. 19 were advocates and 48 were service providers. 49 or 15.4% of survey respondents identified as LGBTQIASB+. 8 were First Nations and 20 identified as culturally and linguistically diverse. We asked, how well do you understand the changes to the NDIS that started on the 3rd of October 2024? 28.5% of survey respondents said they understood the changes very well. 37.6% said they understand a bit. 16.3% said they were unsure. 11.3% said they don't understand much. And 6.3% said they don't understand the changes at all. We also asked, how do you feel about the NDIS changes? sorry, 0.9% of survey respondents said they felt very positive. 3.5% said they felt somewhat positive. 5% said they felt neutral, so had no strong feeling. 12.3% said they were unsure. 27.4% said they felt somewhat negative, and 50.9% said they felt very negative about the changes. We asked, do you feel you have enough support and information to handle these changes? 5% of survey respondents said yes, they felt supported. 13.8% said they felt somewhat supported. 13.2% said they felt unsure. And 28.9% said they felt not very supported. And the remaining 39% said they felt not supported at all. Our next question was, which parts of the recent NDIS changes are you most concerned about? People were asked to tick all the things they felt most concerned about in this question. 43% said access and eligibility requirements, which was applying for NDIS support. 35.6% said limits on new applications if previous access is revoked. 74.1% said rules on what can and cannot be purchased with NDIS funding, the in and out lists. 65.6% said increased powers of the CEO to move a person to agency management. 44.1% said plan duration reduced to 12 months. 75.3% said the support needs assessment and how budgets are set. And 75.6% said eligibility reassessments and evidence gathering requirements. So the top three were the NDIS support lists, the support needs assessment and budgeting, and eligibility reassessments. We asked, since these changes started, have you had more problems with the NDIS? 64.5% of survey respondents said yes, they had. 20.4% said they were unsure or this question wasn't applicable to them, and 15.1% said no. And I will stop sharing and hand back to George so that we can hear from the NDIA.
Thank
Thanks,
you
everyone.
So much, Nick. That's a really interesting survey. We thank people for doing that survey. We don't just do surveys because we think they're fun. No, we do surveys because we want to know what our community is thinking and feeling. And that really showed that our community has a lot of concerns about the current changes that are occurring. And that means that we need to do more to help people to understand the changes and to also hopefully bust some of the myths or the misconceptions around the changes. And that's what we're here to do today. And also to hear from you about your views and concerns. I'm really, really thrilled to have Alex Rosenthal, who is from the NDIA. What's your formal role there, Alex? Welcome.
Thanks, George. Hi, everyone. As George said, my name is Alex, and my title is Branch Manager of Engagement and Inclusion at the NDIA. Thanks for having me.
Amazing. I'm not sorry. And the cool spotlight, Alex, so she's sort of like the main person. Is that better? I said that's better. We can all see you now. Thank you for coming, Alex. Any thoughts on that survey, Alex?
Yeah, I think I understand why people are concerned. As you and Nick have said, there's a lot of changes happening at the same time, and there might be a little bit of miscommunication and maybe some questions that are not being answered, so that causes worry as well. So obviously, I don't want people to feel that way. And so I was concerned about how high that anxiety was for people who responded to the survey. So I'm really grateful to have the opportunity today to kind of talk through some of those concerns that people might have.
All right. All right. Let's go ahead. I know that you prepared a bit of an introduction, so that we can learn a bit more, and then we'll have a conversation. How's that sound?
That sounds great, George.
Thanks, Alex.
I have some people helping me in the background, so Sarah's going to share our PowerPoint. Thank you, Sarah. So before I begin, I wanted to let you know I've got a few team members helping. So Sarah is sharing the presentation for me at the moment, and there's someone else named Candice who's going to drop some useful links to information and resources that are on the website as I talk as well. So the three of us are here from the NDIA. Because today's session is being recorded, I do need to say that the information I'll be providing is general in nature and it's true and correct as of today, as of our time of recording. But as we've discussed, changes are ongoing, and so information may change after the event, and which may impact the accuracy of information provided today. We provide this information in good faith, but it does not necessarily reflect the kind of ongoing and permanent views of the NDIA. So I just needed to provide that disclaimer before I launch in. Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to provide a brief overview of the changes to the NDIS Act. A full summary of these changes is available on the NDIS website. And I will try to move quickly through this presentation so we have more time for questions and answers. So, as I am sure you are very aware, in August, the National Disability Insurance Scheme Amendment Bill was passed by Parliament. This bill is the government's first step to implementing improvements identified as part of the NDIS review. The amendments included in the bill have two main objectives: to clarify the intent of existing legislation and to better align the scheme with its original intent, and to create the scaffolding needed to progress key NDIS review recommendations. Changes to the legislation came into effect on the 3rd of October this year. Many changes will come later, and we will share more information about the future changes, as they take effect. I should say up front that the purpose of the scheme has not changed. It continues and will continue to provide participants and people with disability with disability-related supports. We're taking an educative approach to implementing the new rules and the new Act. This means we're working really hard to make sure that participants and their supporters have all the information that they need about the new rules and understand what it means for their supports. We have delivered a significant communications campaign. Many of you may have received emails and text messages from us, seen us across your social media channels, and also have come along to sessions like today's. So thanks to EAC for hosting us today. We're doing a number of sessions with organisations, and we are also running a number of sessions ourselves. We're doing them multiple times a week. You can join. We will post a link to our events in the chat. The questions being asked at these events are being used by our internal communications teams to update the website and to update the frequently asked questions. So, as George said, we don't just go out and about and ask people what they think for fun. The questions you are asking are directly impacting what information we provide and also that the work the agency is doing to implement these changes. So I will briefly provide an overview of the changes that came into effect from the 3rd of October and things that you will experience from now. Changes you will see now to access and eligibility. Firstly, when someone applies to access the NDIS, we will consider and decide and tell them if they meet the disability requirements, the early intervention requirements, or both. This change impacts people applying to the NDIS, and is something that we're doing to improve the information that we provide participants. So in the past, it might not be clear when you've come in under the disability requirements or the early intervention requirements. And so for new people entering the scheme, we will make this much more clear. The second change is that the access requirements in the Act have been updated to clarify that a person should only access the NDIS if they require supports which are defined as NDIS supports. And there's been changes to also make it clearer when a mainstream system, so that means an education system, a health system, would be responsible for providing support rather than the NDIS. This change also impacts people applying to the NDIS, as well as participants who may need to go through an eligibility reassessment. The third change to access an eligibility is that if a person's status as a participant changes and they no longer meet the scheme eligibility requirements, you can request a review of that decision. That's a reviewable decision, but you cannot submit another access request until that review is complete. So that's a process change that was introduced in these amendments. And then the final change to access and eligibility is about information gathering. So we can now request specific information, reports, or things like assessments if we are considering a person's status as a participant. So if you're going through an eligibility reassessment, we can ask for a specific piece of evidence. This only impacts those participants going through the eligibility reassessment process. The biggest change, and I think what we will spend most of this afternoon talking about, is the new definition of what is and is not an NDIS support. These are supports that can you can use your NDIS funding to purchase. This impacts all participants. I'm only briefly touching on that now, but we have much more to say on that topic as we go through today's session. There are other changes to budgets and planning. So plans approved after the 3rd of October. So if you got a new plan put in place from the 3rd of October, this plan will show total funding amounts, funding component amounts and funding periods. In practice, your plans will look similar. They already had a total funding amount and a plan end date. So that will be continued, but the Act has been updated to reflect what we were already doing in practice. And funding periods for all plans will be for 12 months until next year when we update our systems, and we will introduce longer term plans again after that. And finally, on budgets and planning, specific changes can be made to a participant's plan without the need to create a whole new plan. This is called a plan variation. And again, this is something where the NDIS Act is kind of being amended to catch up with practice that we were already doing. Claims and payments. Sorry, Sarah, I mucked you up. Claims and payments. We've introduced a new claims and payments framework. This provides clarity on how claims should be made. For the first 12 months from the 1st of October, we will continue to honour all claims for supports made before the 3rd of October. However, in the future, all claims must be made within 2 years of providing supports. This impacts mostly providers, but is also relevant for self-managers. I'm going to provide a short overview of some of the changes that will happen in the future over time, but that do not take effect immediately. There are some changes to access and eligibility. There are new rules that in some cases participants will undergo an eligibility reassessment in a particular circumstance. For example, when children turn 9, the implementation of this change is yet to be confirmed, and so further information will be provided at a later date. In the future, participants and people who are new to the scheme, who are joining the scheme for the first time, will receive something called an impairment notice. And I think that that is something else, George, that we'll talk in more detail about as well. Impairment notices is a fancy way of saying an email or a letter when you access the NDIS that outlines the list of impairment categories on which you have met access under the scheme. So I can talk more about that in the Q&A. This helps us move away from a kind of a medical model of disability. Some people might be familiar with primary or secondary disabilities, which is the language the scheme uses now. We want to move away from that language and talk about more global kind of impacts and whole of person impacts. So people accessing the scheme for the first time from the 1st of January next year will receive that impairment notice. We want to provide them to existing participants as well, but that will be done over time in the future at a later date. In the future, a plan budget will be more flexible and it will be based on information from a support needs assessment. So participants will undergo a support needs assessment, which records their whole of person disability support needs, and that will be the basis on which we make a budget decision. This support needs assessment is still to be co-designed, and that process is underway at the moment, and it will be introduced in the future, you know, potentially from starting from middle to late next year. And then finally, there are some changes to plan management. And when I say plan management here, this means how you manage your plan. So agency managed, using a registered plan manager or self-management. There are some changes to what the NDIA has to consider when making that decision, and to make sure that the participant or their nominee are likely to spend their NDIS funding appropriately for NDIS supports and in line with their plan. This is a safeguarding. This is part of our safeguarding improvements, and it will be the detail of which will be outlined in a rule. We want to make sure that
Hold on, Alex. There's a reference in the chat from Dave, the interpreter, who's asked to swap the spotlight for the interpreter, so I'm thinking that they need to change over. Yep.
Thank you.
Will that happen?
Thanks, George. Thanks, Dave. NDIS supports. Just move to the next slide, Sarah. We have introduced a new definition of what is and is not an NDIS support. NDIS supports are services and items that participants can use their funding for to help with their disability-related needs. Participants can only spend their funding on things that are NDIS supports. The NDIS support lists make it clear what funding can be spent on and can't be spent on. And as I mentioned, this impacts all participants. These lists are published on the NDIS website. We will talk more about them, I am absolutely sure. The only thing I want to add now is that this rule at this point in time is temporary. A final rule and a final definition of what is and is not an NDIS support must be agreed by state and territory governments. And so this is expected to be introduced next year. The new definition of NDIS supports also included a new process for replacement supports. So in some individual circumstances, participants will be able to request to use their NDIS funding for a support that is not an NDIS support. This is called a replacement support. A replacement support isn't extra or additional support. It doesn't change the funding, the total funding in your plan, but rather it replaces an NDIS support or support you have been funded for in your plan with something that might be considered in most cases to not be an NDIS support. Only some supports can be replaced, and we have a list of those available on our website as well. The list includes replacement supports, include things such as consumables and standard available household items, and some assistive technology such as smartwatches, tablets, and apps that support communication. There is a process for applying for replacement supports. We will link to it in the chat. We also want to make sure that we're giving people time to adjust and learn About the NDIS support lists, and so there has been a 12-month transition period introduced. This means that for the next 12 months, the NDIA will not raise a debt if someone makes a mistake and purchases something that is not an NDIS support for the first or the second time, or if the support is worth less than $1,500. If someone continues to claim for things that are not NDIS supports, after we have talked to them about these mistakes, that's when we may raise a debt. But we'll always consider individual circumstances. We'll always provide education and support in the first instance, and particularly during this 12-month transition period. The new NDIS Act also provides the NDIA with additional powers to waive debts. As our CEO has said multiple times, this is not about us wanting to catch people out. We know participants want to do the right thing and we want to support them to do the right thing. The transition period was only 30 days for providers, and it doesn't apply if you purchase items that are illegal. Budget amounts and funding periods. This is another change.
Alex, can you repeat
yes.
that last sentence that you just said? It does not apply
So the
when...
transition period, so the process I outlined where we won't raise a debt, doesn't apply if you purchase illegal items. So things that, you know, are not allowed anyway. So
I don't understand.
So if you use your NDIS funding to purchase illegal drugs, you would still owe a debt to the NDIS, as an example.
Does it? Is
Thanks,
that
George.
because it is in the headline legislation? Or is that
Yes.
because it's a crime? I don't. Yep, okay. And what about sexual services?
Sexual services are also not permitted in the Act itself, not in the NDIS support rules. But I don't know if we will specifically raise a debt or if the transition period applies. I do not know that specific. It's not illegal in all states and territories, so I don't know if that line applies. Can I maybe take it on notice and provide it in writing?
Of course, thank you.
Thanks, George. Great question. All right, I'm almost done. Budgets and funding periods. So as I mentioned, from the 3rd of October, there are some changes to the way that plans are constructed. Your actual plan in the portal or your hard copy will look the same, and it will include a total funding amount. That's called a total funding amount. You might already be familiar with those. It will also include details of funding periods. So this is to support us introducing longer term plans. So in the future, you might have a plan that's 3 or 5 years long, but the funding periods might be 12 months long. And so for this point in time, for new plans that are being built from the 3rd of October, everybody's funding period will be 12 months. And from next year, we'll start introducing longer plans and possibly different funding periods. And then the third change to plans is something called funding component amounts. And this is to provide a clearer funding amount for specific groups of supports within your plan. And again, this is to try to support plan flexibility. So rather than having lots of stated supports, we might have a total funding amount for all of your therapy supports as an example. But again, that's not something that's being introduced right now. At this point in time, funding components will align with support categories and our budgets. Sorry. Oh. So your plan will still look the same with core capacity building capital budgets in place. We've also heard a fair bit of feedback that participants really want to better understand their budgets and what their budgets are intended kind of have been built on. And so we've developed a budget breakdown that will be available for plans that have been built after, or plans that have been put in place after the 3rd of October. And that will break down how a delegate, how a planner has come up with the funding in your plan. And so that can be made available to participants on request. As I mentioned, all new plans will be created for 12 months and will have a 12-month funding period. From next year, there will be an option for longer term plans, for example, 3 to 5 years, with shorter funding periods, say 3, 6, or 12 months within them. Any unused funds at the end of a funding period will roll over to the next funding period, and plans approved before the 3rd of October will still continue for the plan duration that they were built for. So if you already have a longer term plan that is 2 years long, that still stays in place. There's no change to those current plans. Funding periods will be discussed with participants during the planning process, and they'll be determined on a range of factors, including your personal preference, the frequency and the type of supports in your plan, and any potential risks identified. We will continue to work with participants to understand support needs, including those that might change quickly or are episodic in nature or less predictable, to make sure that the way your plan is set up supports your needs. This is something that we're thinking about really carefully, and we want to make sure that our systems and our way of delivering the scheme support people to meet their needs. So what happens next? As I mentioned, many of these changes will be implemented over time, and will be implemented using something called NDIS rules. They sit underneath the NDIS Act. These rules will be implemented in stages, we will continue to provide information on opportunities for consultation on these rules, as well as information on changes and when they impact participants and what they mean for participants. That's my intro. Back to you, George.
Thank you very much, Alex. The chat's been running hot while you've been speaking. I'd like to bring your attention to a couple of them, but I will also say that we're going to download the chat, and we will, if it's okay with you, Alex, pass on any questions that we don't have time to explore today, and hopefully we'll be able to get people the answers that they're looking for through that process. There's a good question from Graham Taylor here. What does the NDIA mean by flexibility when there is an in and an out list? Isn't that less flexibility? So you said that the plans will be more flexible, but we've got those in and out lists.
Really.
How would that be more flexible?
The intent is to make the NDIS a bit less confusing. When we have been speaking with participants over the last decade as we've been implementing the scheme, particularly self-managers have said, if you could just tell me what I'm allowed to spend my money on. And so the intent is that your budget in your plan has more flexibility, is more general. It is, funding allocated not by particular lines, but by categories or budgets, and that participants then can make their own informed purchasing decisions using resources like the what is an NDIS support and what is not an NDIS support rules.
Thank you, Alex. I wanted to give you an opportunity to talk about some of the common myths that you've been seeing or hearing about. So the part of today is that we can clarify misunderstandings. Would you like to speak about some of those, or what you've seen? I mean,
yeah.
I think that the One very hot topic is around short-term accommodation. Would you
That is
like to
a.
talk about
I would love to talk about short-term accommodation, George. Thank you for prompting me to talk about this. It is absolutely a hot topic. It is coming up in every single one of our sessions. So I'm so glad you raised it first. So the first thing I want to say is that the NDIS Act and the changes to what is and is not an NDIS support have not changed the way that we fund or the way you can access short-term accommodation. Short-term accommodation, or respite as it's sometimes known, is designed to help informal carers continue to deliver their caring role and to give participants and their carers a mutually beneficial break from one another. And so the way we fund it hasn't changed. Participants can be funded for up to 14 days to a maximum of 28 days per year in their plans. It does not need to be specifically stated in your plan to access it, and it can still be accessed flexibly using your core budget. Generally, short-term accommodation funding can be used for assistance with self-care or community access, as well as accommodation itself. You can use your STA funding in a centre or group kind of provider as delivered by a registered or unregistered provider. And you can also, if you're a self-manager or a plan manager, continue to access unregistered short-term accommodation providers. What is important to remember is that short-term accommodation or respite is not intended to support holidays or tourist travel. And so it's not appropriate to use short-term accommodation for things that are not NDIS supports. For example, cruises, holiday packages, airfares, visas, activities, kind of theme park tickets, those types of things that are not NDIS supports. We do know that lots of people are asking us for information about short-term accommodation, and so we're working on an updated guideline. Some of you online might be familiar with our operational guidelines. We're working on a short-term accommodation guideline, and we're working really hard to have that published before the end of the year, so that it is very clear what is and isn't allowed under short-term accommodation.
Thanks, Alex. I saw recently the info that came out said that if you are in supported independent living, that you won't be able to access STA. Is that right?
Yeah,
Is that a myth or
generally,
is that true?
well, generally, short-term accommodation is funded for people who live with their informal carers. So people who live with family or friends, and who provide them with kind of day-to-day support. So it's intended for people who live with informal carers. So people who live alone or in settings like supported independent living, it probably wouldn't be something we would fund for them.
Okay, and what's the difference between a holiday and respite?
Great question, George. I use an example in our sessions that is a little bit tongue in cheek, so this is said with a little bit of humor. But if
You
you are a
know
self-managing
I love a
participant
bit
who
of
lives with,
humor, Alex.
I just don't want people to be offended. It's said in a light-hearted example, but my example is it would be appropriate to use your STA funding for something like an Airbnb in the same city that you live in, but it wouldn't be appropriate to use it for an Airbnb in Bali. And so, short-term accommodation or respite is really just about getting a break, and it should be mutually beneficial for your carers and yourself, but it's not about funding a holiday. So, it does require you to think about your own personal circumstances, but that's my little example. It would be okay close by, it probably wouldn't be okay overseas.
But what if you pay for your own flight to Bali? And maybe the Airbnb in Bali is less expensive. That'll be good for the agency.
I don't think that that would be with the intent of what that funding is meant for, George.
Okay.
But as I say, we're working on a policy that will hopefully help reduce some of the grey and be very clear on what is allowed and what is not allowed, because we're getting lots of questions like that at the moment, George.
Okay, thank you. What other things do you want to risk us today?
I wanted to talk about impairment categories and specifically what do impairment categories mean for people with autism. I know that this has come up. I can't see the chat while I'm talking, but I don't know if it's come up today, but it has come up in a lot of other conversations I've had with participants. And there's, I think, a little bit of concern that because the impairment categories don't specifically include autism, that that might mean that people with autism can't access the scheme. And so I wanted to say up front that that is absolutely not the case. People with autism will still be able to access the scheme. And the way that a diagnosis such as autism will, the way an impairment notice will look for someone accessing the scheme with a primary disability of autism, will that their impairment notice will say that they have met access under the neurological impairment category. But you can have more than one impairment category listed on your notice. So you can also meet access requirements for intellectual disability, cognitive, physical, or psychosocial. So the two things I wanted to say were people with disability who are entering the scheme for the first time from the 1st of January can meet access under multiple impairment categories. It is not just one or two. You can meet access under multiple, and that just because autism isn't specifically listed as a category does not mean autism is excluded from the scheme. So that was something I wanted to address up front. Thanks, George.
Thank you. And if people receive an impairment notice and they go, "Oh, this is a bit wrong. This hasn't reflect my disabilities," what can they do?
The impairment notice is a reviewable decision, so they can ask for a review
Thank
at
you.
any time as well. If you feel like your circumstances change, you can ask for the impairment notice to be updated over time as well.
Is there anything that people should be doing now to ensure that that impairment notice is accurate in January?
At this point in time, it will only be introduced for people accessing the scheme. So for people who are already participants, it's not something that will happen from the 1st of January. It's only people who are new to the scheme from the 1st of January. And the way that we make decisions at access is not changing. So we will still use the same evidence that is submitted at access to decide what your access kind of decision is, and therefore what is included in your impairment notice.
But people
So
who are
nothing.
already on the NDIS, and who are likely most people here today, when will they receive their impairment notice?
We haven't worked that out yet, George. We're still working out how do we give it to participants and when they will get it. So it will happen over time, probably starting from sometime next year, but we haven't got those details yet.
Thank you. There was a bit of news that came out yesterday that I'm sure you're aware of, and that is about music and art therapy. And you I'd raised this today. It's been all over the chat.
Of
Um,
course.
and I have to tell you, I read the statement by the NDIA, and I think I know the NDIS quite well. And I sat there and I was like, I don't really understand what this statement is saying. But I said, that's okay. I'm going to see Alex tomorrow and I can ask her.
So I'm glad you asked, George. I have seen some pop-ups talking about this from the chat, so I'm very glad you've raised it. As I mentioned, in implementing these changes, we have realized that there are lots of areas where we need to provide clearer information. And one of those is, what is a therapy support? What is therapy under the NDIS? And so we've been working on some updated guidance on what is classified as therapy under the NDIS. And so that guidance will be released very soon. And as part of that, we've undertaken a review of evidence and information. And and made a decision that from next year, from the 1st of February, art and music therapy won't be classified as a therapy. You can still continue to access those services, but the way that you claim for them in your plan will change. So they won't be claimed under the therapy line item, but they will be claimed under the community participation items.
Wow. Does that why
We
are all the
published.
therapy why all the therapy organizations are represent the providers so unhappy? Because that doesn't sound like a problem. Why aren't people unhappy about this?
I think because I can't speak for them, I obviously work for the agency and not those organizations, but I think they might be upset because that's a change in how much money that they can claim from participant plans for the services that they provide.
Okay, so that might mean that those providers will say, "I'm what was the what is there a big difference in the price that they would claim compared to what they will be able to claim?" I mean, I saw that the amount is $67 an hour. What was it before? Maybe someone can put
Oh,
that in
you're
the
quizzing
chat.
me on details of our pricing
No, I'm
arrangements
sorry,
that
I
I
shouldn't
don't
have done
know.
that.
Sorry.
That's okay.
No, that's okay. The new rate, I have the new rate, so I can pop the details of the new rate from the 1st of February, and I'll have to come back to you on the current rate.
Right,
But I
thank you.
will just pop in the chat if I can do two things at
Thank
once.
you. All right. What I'd like to do now is just check with you, Alex, if there were any other key issues that you wanted to list off. And if not, we'll open up the chat and open up the conversation. Were there any other things that you wanted to risk off?
I'm happy to open it up.
Excellent. Okay. So, what we're going to do is everyone's going to chance to put their hand up and ask a question. I just want to remind everyone that we want to have a really respectful and open conversation. Alex is a lovely human being. He's just doing her job. And I want us all to be really nice to Alex because I like Alex. All right, on that note, I'm gonna
Thanks,
go
George.
to Carolyn and then Greg. Carolyn.
Thanks, George. Hi, Alex. I'm wanting to ask a question about the recent
G'day.
frequently asked questions information on the website that relates to the holidays question. Now, we all know that participants haven't been able to pay for their own holiday expenses at any time. That's always been the status. But what's the reasoning for the NDIA saying that the SHADS award entitlements for reimbursement of reasonable accommodation and travel cost for support workers is not to be paid?
This is a very interesting question. You are not the first person to ask me this in the last 24 hours. It's something that I have gone back to our policy teams to clarify. And as I say, the full guideline on short-term accommodation will speak to more detail than the FAQs that are currently on the website.
It's not a short-term accommodation question.
Hi, Bergie.
Yeah.
Hi, Danny.
Hi, Nurse.
It's a question pertaining to the meeting
Can we put everyone on mute, please? And Matt, can you put that up, please? All right, sorry. Carolyn?
Yeah, I was just wanting Alex to be understanding my question. It's not a short-term accommodation question. It's not about respite. It's about people exercising choice and control in their own lives for a range of reasons, career reasons, connecting with family, a range of reasons, going to a funeral of a relative, all sorts of reasons that people might need to be away from their primary residence for a purpose that's a perfectly ordinary life purpose, not a respite purpose. And if they have high intensity support needs, they can't go to that funeral or that wedding or that whatever unless they have their trained supports with them. And my question is, why cannot the reasonable travel and accommodation cost of the worker be claimed?
Firstly, is that true, Alex? Are you not allowed to claim the cost of the worker if you need that worker on the plane with you? And if they're not on the plane with you, you will probably die because there'll be no one to help you to adjust if you fall over and can't breathe. Sorry, just an example.
So you can... Thank you for the example, George. You can definitely pay for the support worker hours. Absolutely. If you are traveling for work or for fun, you can absolutely pay for a support worker that you need for that period of time. I think the question is about the travel component. And that is a question that I know we have been asked, but I don't have a neat answer for. I have asked the team in the background to try to get some detailed answers, and we'll try to post it in the chat before the end of the session. But I don't know the details of the pricing arrangements on that question. I'm so sorry, but we'll try to come back to you.
Thanks, Alex. Just my opinion for what it's worth. When people travel and they're traveling for work, someone has to pay for their accommodation. When an able-bodied person travels, they don't need to pay for two tickets. Why should a person with a disability? So we'll just leave that with you and look forward to hearing back from you. Thank you, Carolyn. The next question is from Greg and then Kathy.
Hi, Alex. Yeah, a quick question for you. Obviously, going back to the art of music therapy, we're not a provider that provides that, but I could appreciate absolutely their concern because the rate has gone, will be going from $193.99 to $68, from what I understand I've seen. But it does also then raise alarm bells for providers of what other services are in the firing line. As recently as in the last week, we've been told by support coordinators and plan managers, and of course, we don't know how accurate this is, that things like exercise physiology are under review as well. So is there any comment that could be made as far as what other services might subsequently also be under review for these guidelines?
Thanks. Thanks, Greg. So the therapy guideline will talk about the types of therapy supports that the NDIS funds. So that will provide further detail. There is not a list of particular supports that are under review by the NDIS. As part of these reforms, the government did announce the establishment of an evidence advisory committee under the Department of Social Services to provide advice on what is evidence-based supports. That committee is being established as we speak, and they will have their own agenda, and the NDIA can refer things to them to ask for expert advice. And the first thing that we are referring to them is art and music therapy. But at this stage, there is not kind of another volume of types of supports that we would be referring. I think the definitions of what is and is not an NDIS support, we have tried to be as detailed and clear as we possibly can. And where we haven't, that's why we're working on the therapy OG to really define what is kind of evidence-based therapy. So, there's not kind of a to-do list, I guess, yep. For that. But there will be this new committee that will look into particular things.
Okay, thanks.
That's a good question. And I didn't want to listen to Alex, is that evidence committee, hasn't been established, but a decision feels like it's already been made. I'm just relaying a comment from Steve Diggins in the chat that you would think that you would firstly set up a committee, the committee would gather evidence and then work out what's evidence-based. It's odd that we haven't even done that and we've decided that one therapy or two are not worthy of the pay that they were, the professional pay that they were previously receiving. Just leave that one with you as a comment, Alec, from the chat. Cassie and then Ashley, it'd be nice to see your faces if you happy to. Hello, Cassie.
Hi, hello everyone. It is nice to see faces. A quick question around the short-term accommodation versus day programs that go on for about 6 hours or so, and how they are tied into respite or short-term accommodation versus holiday. The way I read the short-term accommodation, not being able to go see a theatre or go to a water slide, go out for dinner, go listen to music, seems like I'm sending my child from a bedroom to another bedroom. Part of the respite and their skill building is obviously interacting with other people and the community. And it just sounds to me, feels to me like we're just trying to lock them up. To send them to accommodation as a second point is more expensive than to have my daughter go and spend 6 hours, outdoors, So they go to Adventure World in Geelong, wherever, on a sunny day, and comes back home happy and tired. That's going to cost me a lot less, but you're saying, or the NDIS is saying, is no fun allowed, or you have to pay for your own tickets. If that's the case, then I'd like to know why my daughter isn't getting paid for 3 days of work that she does, because she doesn't have a graduate certificate to get paid employment or paid work. She can't afford to be going out in the community if she has to pay for all the little pleasures that you get with going out. That's really, it mystifies me. as to why you, the rules about theatre and, the component of why you go out is to have fun, but you can't really. You've got to have a support worker, and basically that means shipping her from one room to another.
Can I add to that, Cathy? One thing that what you said, really so true, that I'm thinking that the risk here is that people or children will not want to leave the house. They won't want to go and leave their
Absolutely.
families to vote. That's going to be a big problem. Alex, any thoughts?
Yeah, thanks, Kathy. And thanks for sharing you and your daughter's personal experience. I appreciate that. If your daughter's accessing those supports and those day programs through a registered provider that in the way that they claim kind of bundles those costs, then that is still permitted under the rules. That provider
They're
can
not
still
registered.
claim.
They're not registered, just in case that makes a difference.
Then yes, it does. And so that then means that those activity costs would need to be met by the participant. So absolutely, the support workers and the supports that are needed to help her go to the adventure park, absolutely covered by the NDIS, but the admission to the adventure park would not be.
Thanks.
So the point being that Kate can't afford to do that, so therefore she I'm trying to set her up as an adult. She's 30 years old. She can't afford to be having the experiences that she's had. And just like in terms of the scheme, just so you know, she chooses many activities she's been to and doesn't want to go again. It's not like a mad rush to go, everything. So once she's had that experience, to your point, George, she can actually have that, that self, gratification of actually making a choice. I don't want to go there. It's not fun. But the point that I'm trying to make is that as her mother and as control of her plan, she can't afford to go anywhere. I mean, she's got. We used
So,
to.
Kathy, we've got 8 hands up and we've got 20
Yeah,
minutes.
that's fine.
So, I think it really, but I think that your point is a really important one. And it's been heard, and we will all keep
Thank you. Thanks for your
advocating for
time.
this. Thank you. And Ashley, and then Bonnie, and then Daniel. Ashley.
Is everything loading? Yep. I'm sorry if I asked two questions and I realize one might be taken on notice. With regard to STA, and is the agency saying there's literally no circumstances at all where someone could access that support if they're not living with informal supports? I ask this having seen the draft OG and it references it but makes it sort of clear that never. And then the easier question that I think for everyone here, with regards to the news about the creative therapies, following Minister Shorten's appearance on Sky News, I'm seeing a lot of people who now believe so long as they individually can provide enough evidence that it is beneficial and effective, they will be able to continue having it funded at the 194 rate as a capacity building support. Is it an individual basis or what comes from the EAC when it comes back?
Alex, let's start. Two questions. Which one do you want to answer first?
So, Ashley, could you repeat the first question? Sorry. It was
Yeah,
about.
literally, STA, is it
Yes.
absolutely off the table if you don't live with
Don't live
informal?
with. Thank you. Of
Sorry.
course, everybody's plan is individual and reasonable and necessary decisions are made based on individual circumstances. So I don't think I can be definitive and say it is absolutely out for everyone who lives alone or who does not live with their informal carers. There may always be individual circumstances that would mean it would be reasonable and necessary to fund for a participant, but generally, it would be for people who live with informal carers. That's exactly right. So
And
the intent of short-term accommodation is for a mutually beneficial break apart. So there will be some, I'm sure there will absolutely be exceptions and there will still be individual circumstances and reasonable and necessary decisions are still made by a human considering what a participant needs. So nothing in
but
the
then to
NDIS
access
is
it using their
100%.
funding flexibly, where we are stuck with the OG. Like, it's going to be a complicated one, I know, but we just have to wait to see what comes out.
Yeah, sorry, I'm not following the flexibility. Short-term
It's
accommodation is still
rarely
something you
stated
can
in a
access.
plan.
That's right.
So
So
it
it's
will
still
be,
something you can access
people are going to
flexibly.
be scared of a debt being raised massively.
So I'm not sure I'm exactly following, but let me have a go. If you are, for
I'm going to kill my camera.
For example, a self-managing participant who lives vacation flexibly using their core funding, is that what
the audio is breaking up? So I only heard 10% of the question.
Oh,
I'm happy to put that one to the side. The audio is going really bad for me.
Okay, sorry, Ashley. Yeah. I'm sorry.
That's okay. Can I help? Can I help with this? I think what I've heard is that in almost all cases, it will only be allowed for people who are living with their informal support people, but there might be some exceptions. Now, Ashley, your other question was about an interview that Bill Shorten did, where he said that if there's evidence that the therapy is beneficial, then it will be funded at the higher rate. Are you aware of that interview, Alex?
Yes, and good question, Ashley. If you have art or music therapy already stated in a plan, you can continue accessing that support. If it's specifically stated under your capacity building budget as art or music therapy, then it's absolutely something you can continue to access. And in the future, this will continue to be the case. So if there is evidence that a participant requires art or music therapy as specifically a capacity building support, then it can be stated in a plan. But yes, it would have to be based on individual evidence and would have to be made as an individual reasonable and necessary decision. In general, from 1st of February, this is something that we're moving to say it's something that is more appropriately funded under the core community participation items.
All right, thank you. Ashley, we need to keep moving. Bonnie and then Daniel.
George, I'm a social worker, and I guess my question is, we're seeing some of the new plans come through, and in the improved daily living budget, we're noticing that it's reading as though they're stated. So it might be, stated 20 hours of physio and, 10 hours of speech, whereas previously the participant may have been accessing some social work as well. And we're just wondering, because it's stated, it's kind of as though that there's loss of choice and control around the improved daily living budget. Is that something we're going to see from the NDIS come through more and more, where actually it's kind of dictated therapy services that they can receive?
Great question, Bonnie, thank you for asking it. I think it's an excellent question. The intent of all of these reforms is to move away from individual stated supports in a plan and to actually have a more general plan that is more flexible overall, and so that participants can make individual choices about how they spend their funding using resources like the NDIS support lists. That's the intent. As we move through this transition period, we are trying to resolve some of the grey areas that have existed in the scheme for 10 years. And I think what is therapy is one of those. And so there will be further detail on what we consider an evidence-based therapy released imminently through that operational guideline. And in some instances, we will use the tools that we have available to us, such as stating a support, to make sure that a specific support has funding allocated to it in a plan and to make sure that participants can access that support. The intent is, though, that we want to move away from stating lots and lots and lots of supports and genuinely kind of increase more flexibility in that regard, Bonnie. So we're in this awkward transition period where we're using a combination of different things. But in the future, we want to use things like funding components to possibly say, this is your total therapy budget. These are the therapies that are allowed, but you have choice and control over which ones you utilize.
Okay, I just have one other quick question if I can cheekily sneak that in. I just wanted to ask.
No, that's all right.
You're getting cut off, Bonnie. Sorry.
Daniel,
facilitator
friend.
George. Thanks.
Yeah. No, all good. It's fine. Daniel.
George.
Oh, Daniel, your sound is not great. No, sorry, Daniel. No.
Hang on. I'm going to turn off my video.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm in an area with bad reception, sorry.
That's all right.
Look, I will do my utmost to stay on point. Many people in this meeting will understand that I have more than a few reasons why I may have not great feelings about where we are right now. So I just wanted to touch on two points. I don't expect an answer. I want to pass this as comment. Firstly, the changes to STA, and please stop gaslighting us, telling us that there's been no changes to STA. There's absolutely been significant changes to STA that are having massive, terrible impacts to a hell of a lot of NDIS participants. And you will find that the most vulnerable NDIS participants are those who are being most heavily impacted by this. There have been historically many other uses of STA that have been actively supported by the agency that now the agency is wiping their hands of, and many of which have been mentioned by other people today. And secondly, I want to just touch on the point around someone who uses supports when they are, for example, out of town. The travel cost, the accommodation, the award the SHADS award requirement for meals and so forth for the workers, that is an ancillary cost of a funded support. The Act actively supports the participant to use their funding in that way. And any OG that says otherwise is actively against the wording of the Act. The agency better have their lawyers ready because we'll be coming for them.
That's better.
Thank you.
A point well made. Nothing personal, Alex. I know you haven't made all this sense yourself. Kristen, are you there?
I am, thank you. I'm sorry, I'm going to have to leave my camera off because my camera's screwed and I can't afford a new laptop. I'm going to give you a question on notice, Alex, and I'm not directing this at you personally, it's at the agency, but as a participant who has two invisible disabilities who has been had like life-changing impacts, positive life-changing impacts from art therapy as capacity building over a number of years. I want to ask, and this is a real question, so you please pass it on. I want the agency to give an undertaking that they will give reasonable notice of making changes that actually fracture trust relationships that have taken years to build, to give at least a month's notice. This 1 week's notice is so traumatizing for so many of us. And, you know, I'm on a pension. I can't afford to just go and pay the copay, this is the kind of pushing costs onto participants, by sleight of hand and saying, oh, no, it's still funded. Well, no, it's not still funded. Sorry. Part of my disabilities is I have trouble with other people, you know, most of my trauma is interpersonal. So I can't do art therapy with a group of other people. I have to do it alone. So, you know, this kind of stuff is not okay. It's causing lots of trauma for people. You know, I've spent most of the weekend and a week since I got the news absolutely beside myself. So, you know, the agency needs to start making a commitment to being better trauma informed. You know, it doesn't take rocket science. It's not, you know, such a hard thing to work out that you don't just give people a week's notice for this stuff. So that's what I wanted to raise. So please, we want an answer on that. Thank you.
Thank you, Kristen. I think that's really important. Karen and then Kim. And then that might be the end of time. Oh, not the end of time. The end of our session. Karen. Oh, you're on mute, Karen? Can someone unmute Karen?
No, you're right. I forget these things. There's too many buttons to push. I have a lack of energy-based disability. So my functional capacity building is incredibly challenging, and I started acupuncture treatment, for which there is medical aid-based evidence for my condition. 2 weeks ago, the NDIS declined my claim, saying, I've been doing it for 12 months, so doesn't that go against what is still claimable on the same plan? And my allied health, like my OT, my physio, are doing everything in their power regarding reports, because they've seen how beneficial it's been for me. They've seen how I've been able to better utilize my plan, but it's not on the yes list. It's not on the no list. It is a real therapy, and there is evidence for the condition that I have that shows it's highly beneficial. So I feel I'm in a real grey area, as does my OT and physio with this.
Sorry, Karen. What was the specific support that you said?
Acupuncture.
Sorry, I missed it when the sound broke up a little bit. So, Jen, acupuncture is not an NDIS support. It is something that has been included as a not NDIS support. So, unfortunately, it would be something that you cannot access using your NDIS funding.
Okay.
Sorry, Karen.
Thanks, George.
Kim. And then we'll have one more as well, and then that'll be it.
Okay, thank you. I have put a bunch of questions in the chat as well, so you'll get me ad nauseum later. The main one that I want to talk about is that basically the elephant that's always in the room, and that is planners and plan managers. Can somebody please educate them? Can somebody please go and rap on a few doors? Because people are being told, I'm not going to fund that. It is not the choice of a plan manager to tell somebody they're not going to fund something. They haven't read the documentation. They haven't looked at the meeting that's been held. They haven't been involved in the therapeutic support of the individual. Can somebody please get out, whether it's you guys, whichever department it is, because that as well comes back to, I've had at least three meetings where I've said to planners, what's happening with the disability that this person wants to add? And their response is, I'm sorry, that's somebody else's department, that's access, and I don't do access, I'm only here to do your plan. People are being disregarded, they're being disrespected, and then when they finally get their plan, they're being disregarded and disrespected again, because plan managers think they can control their spending. The budget is reasonable and necessary. It has been deemed as reasonable and necessary. We now have an in-out list. People, as Karen prior to me was saying, have on their previous plans 12 months to use what is stated. And also, as I've said in my question in the chat, can somebody please use some new terminology? Because a behaviour support plan or an SDA is a stated support. They have to be used for that. But when a daily living budget is a stated support, that's flexible across all therapies. Can you please be clear on your language? Because people are confused.
Thank you, Kim.
And that's not directed at you, Alex. That's just frustration coming out on those two particular areas of planners. Please train them properly, because the good ones are amazing. We actually send in a compliment for someone, but the bad ones.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
That's it.
Kim, can I speak briefly, George, to a couple of things Kim has raised? Because I think, and I know that you are not alone, Kim. This is raised in every single session. And so I want to absolutely validate you that we hear the issues that participants are experiencing, getting accurate, timely, accessible communications from us. We get it. We haven't got it right and we need to do better. We have delivered extensive training to our partners and our staff on these legislative changes. But as you all know, we're moving very fast through a period of change. And so you're right, it's something we are still working on. And I just want to really say we take that feedback really seriously. And I don't want that to be the experience of participants. On plan managers. On plan managers, we're doing the same outreach and education with plan managers. So we've had dedicated info sessions, encourage them to contact the agency and get the information that accurate as well, because I agree they shouldn't be kind of the police of the NDIS. Sorry, George. Thank you, Kim.
You're the last person, Avril.
Hi, George. Yes, my question is the in and out lists for those with 24/7 care and perhaps others to continence care, and it speaks about on the in list, it's and skin care. It speaks about all the necessary items. However, on the out lists under food and groceries, you've got groceries including all food, beverage, cleaning, household and health products. This is very confusing to me, because a lot of the creams, etc., that are necessary for both skin and continence care are cleaning. You know, they mm-hmm. are. So I don't know how to interpret that.
Hello.
Things related to your disability support needs are still allowed, Avril. So it shouldn't matter where you purchase them. So, for example, if you know, it doesn't really matter where you bought creams or nappies or enemas, if you purchase them from a chemist or Coles or online, like that, they are still things that are appropriate and would be funded and can be, you can use your NDIS funding to access those.
Yeah. Thank you for that answer. Can I ask another short question?
Well,
George might yell at us.
George?
We're okay. out of time.
Thanks, George.
The interpreters have other jobs, so unfortunately I need to cut it. I want to say a huge thank you to Alex. Alex, you're a bit of a legend. Thank you for coming and sharing and answering the questions. I appreciate it, and I know that people here appreciate it. I hope that you'll come back again.
And we will take all of the comments and questions from the chat as well. So really appreciate everybody engaging in this. And thank you for having me. I feel like I'm coming onto your turf, Nick and George. So thanks for inviting us here. I really appreciate it. And as I said, we're running lots of these sessions. So please continue to join and continue to have conversations with us.
Thank you. Nick, Avery, did you want to plug the survey before we close the survey, Nick? The survey is done. Let's put the PowerPoint up. Yep.
Sorry, I couldn't unmute. So it's on the last slide, folks, and I'll also put it in the chat. Please do share it widely. We want as many people to respond to this survey as possible because it's really helpful for our advocacy work.
Thank you. You can still have your say on financial support at the DSS and James website. Make sure that you follow us on Facebook and Twitter, Instagram, and make sure that you subscribe to our supporters list as well. Thank you, everyone. We will see you at our next event. Bye for now.
Thank you, everyone. And a big thank you to Alex. We really appreciate you talking to us today.